Hi everybody, this video is an introduction to hypothesis tests. In this video we're going to talk about sort of what a hypothesis test is, how to phrase claims and our alternative and null hypotheses, and how to interpret the results. We're not actually going to go through any of the calculations in this video. We'll do the actual calculations in the next video. So when we're talking about hypothesis tests, we're considering some kind of claim about a population parameter, and we'll be talking about means, standard deviations, and proportions. And we want to know, how do we know if that claim is true or not? So I have a few example claims here. The first is the claim that only children have a higher IQ than average. So this is a claim that we're making about all only children, that would be our population. And we're claiming that the mean of those IQ values is higher than average, and average for IQ values is 100. So here we would be claiming that the mean for this population is bigger than 100. This would be our claim written in symbolic form, sort of as an inequality here. Here's another claim. A meat producer claims that their beef contains no more than 20% fat. So this is a claim about a proportion, right? Here we have this 20% here. The population here would be sort of all of the beef that they produce. And like always, we would expect that the fat content would vary a little bit, but this claim is saying that the proportion, so that would be P less than or equal to 0.20 or 20%. So it could be 20% or less, but not any more than that. So that would be our claim in symbolic form there. So this is a claim about a proportion. And then my third example here is a builder wishes to test the claim that the breaking strength of steel wire varies by 0.7. So this is a statement about the standard deviation. So a steel wire would be rated at a certain breaking strength, and this is looking at, well, how far away from that rating would we expect the wire to actually be. So if the claim is that the breaking strength of steel wire is 0.7, or the standard deviation is 0.7, then in symbolic terms this would just be sigma equals 0.7. So all of these claims are either going to be an equation, like we had here, or an inequality, like we had here, involving some kind of population parameter, whether that's a proportion, or a mean, or a standard deviation. And we want to be able to conclude whether this claim is correct or not based upon collecting data. So the first step in this process is to actually take our claim that's written in words and write it in a symbolic form as either an equation or an inequality. So that's what we just did in these three examples. We've got our statement about the mean, proportion, and standard deviation here. And then the second step is to identify what are called the null hypothesis and the alternative hypotheses. And the way this works in practice is we take our original claim, right, whatever that looked like. We then write down what would be the total opposite of that. So if mu wasn't bigger than 100, what would it be? In this case, our opposite claim would be mu less than or equal to 100. That would be the complete opposite of what we had here. The opposite claim for p less than or equal to 0.2 would be p greater than 0.2. And then our opposite claim for the sigma statement would be sigma does not equal 0.7. So that's our opposite claim and our original claim. Now the null hypothesis, which our book writes with capital H sub 0, is always going to be an equation. It's always going to be something equal. So in this case we would have mu equals 100, here we would have p equals 0.2, and here we have sigma equals 0.7. So no matter what kind of claim you had originally, the null hypothesis is always going to be something exactly equal something else. And we'll talk about what we're going to do with the null hypothesis in this next step. Then the other piece is the alternative hypothesis. And the alternative hypothesis is going to be related to our original claim, but it's sort of the opposite of the null hypothesis. So when we have the original claim and the opposite claim, we want to pick one of these to be the alternative hypothesis, and it's going to be whichever one does not contain equality. So here we had a greater than and a less than or equal to. We're not going to use the less than or equal to one. We're going to use the greater than one because that does not contain an equal sign. So the null hypothesis is always inequality. The alternative hypothesis is whichever one of these doesn't have an equal sign. In this case, it's the same as the original claim. This one here, the one that doesn't have the equal sign would be p greater than 2. That was the opposite of our claim. And then here, this would be the not equal to 0.7. So once we've identified the null and alternative hypotheses, we're going to essentially test the likelihood that the null hypothesis is true. So we're going to collect data on whatever it is that we're talking about, to collect some kind of sample data, and then we're going to look at, based on that data, what's the probability that that null hypothesis is true. And if the probability is very small, if the probability is less than this error value called alpha, if it's less than that, then we say, okay, it doesn't sound like H0 is going to be true, right? It has a low probability, so we would reject the null hypothesis. But if our probability is not too small, not necessarily large, but greater than our error cutoff, we would fail to reject the null hypothesis. And we'll look at kind of what this means in the next step as well. So the alpha value we're talking about, just like with the confidence intervals, we had the 95% confidence interval, and that corresponded to an alpha of 0.05. This is the same idea. So our alpha is typically a small amount. 5% is very common, 0.05 or 0.01, 0.02, 0.1, something like that. So just to give you kind of a picture of what we would be looking at when we're trying to find the probability that the null hypothesis is true, here I have those three examples we were looking at earlier, right? The statement about only children's IQ, the statement about the fat content in meat, and the statement about the steel strength. And here were the null and alternative hypotheses for each of those. And based upon each of these types of tests, we're going to compute what's called a test statistic. And I'm not going to look at computing those here. I will do separate videos working out these calculations. But we've got different test statistics for different types of parameters. For proportions, we've got a Z parameter or a Z test statistic. For means, we're typically going to use a T distribution, and for standard deviation, we're typically going to use the chi-squared distribution, just like we saw with the confidence intervals. So in each of these pictures, we have this sort of graph in mind. This would be a t-distribution graph here. And because our alternative hypothesis in this first case is mu greater than 100, we would say that this is a right-tailed test. So greater than 100, we're imagining that going off to the right. So we would have a picture something like this. In comparison, this one here, p greater than 0.2, this is actually also a right-tailed test. Of course, if we had any that were a value less than a number, that would be a left-tailed test, and we'd go off to the left-hand side on the graph. This last one, sigma not equal to 0.7, this is a two-tailed test. If you don't have an inequality pointing one way or the other, it means that you're going to have two tails on the right and the left-hand side. And these tails represent a critical region or a probability value. There's two different methods for computing these, but in one case, what we would look at is the test statistic, which would give us either a t-score or a z-score or a chi-squared score somewhere in here. Then this area, in this case to the right, would be our p-value, right? This is sort of the probability that we would be beyond the test statistic, in this case larger than the test statistic. Same thing here, this would be the p-value. And in this last case, the p-value would be these two areas put together. So if this p-value is very small, that basically means that H0 has a low probability of being true. And this depends upon what alpha is, so this might be a probability of less than 5% or less than 1%. So if H0 has a very low probability of being true, we would reject the null hypothesis. If the p-value is not too small, if there's a decent chance, we would say that H0 could be true. Now technically it could be true in either case, right? But in this first case we're just saying it's very unlikely to be true. In the second case we're saying, okay, maybe it's true. We can't really conclude that it isn't the case, so we can't reject it. And so here we fail to reject it. And you'll notice if you're doing the reading that it really emphasizes that we either reject the null hypothesis or we fail to reject it. We don't ever actually accept it. There's no way to say, yes, the null hypothesis is true. We can only say, no, we don't think it's true, or there's just not enough evidence to say that it isn't true. We can either reject it or fail to reject it. So then the last step to this process, once we decide whether we're going to reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis, we have to figure out, you know, how do we state that in terms of the original conclusion? Because if you're writing a study, you can't just say, we rejected the null hypothesis, because people aren't going to know what that means. We have to interpret that as in, you know, what does that say about our original claim? So looking back at these first examples, we were looking at IQ of only children, and our claim was that their IQ was greater than average or greater than 100. So we have two different cases here. If we reject the null hypothesis, so our null hypothesis was that their IQ was exactly 100. So if we reject that, we're essentially saying, okay, we don't think that's true. Instead, we think that the alternative hypothesis is true, which in this case is the same as our original claim. So here, if we rejected the null hypothesis, we would say there is sufficient evidence to say that only children have higher than average IQ. We're basically supporting our original claim, or supporting, in this case, the alternative hypothesis. Now, that doesn't mean that we're 100% certain, right? There's always going to be some amount of error here, but if we're claiming that the null hypothesis seems to be unlikely to be true, then in this case that would support our claim. On the other hand, if we fail to reject the null hypothesis, then that means that we're not really sure. Maybe the null hypothesis is true. And that means that we don't have enough evidence to support our claim. So we would say there is not enough evidence to support the claim that only children have higher than average IQ. So whether we reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis has to do with the data that we're looking at. But based upon this, we can either say that there is enough evidence to, in this case, support the claim, or there is not enough evidence to support the claim. Now that doesn't mean that the claim is false, it's just that we can't say for sure. Next example here, this was the claim about the fat content in meat. So that original claim was that the proportion of fat or the percentage of fat was less than or equal to 20% or no more than 20%. So again, we're referring to our null hypothesis. So if we reject the null hypothesis, that means we're saying it is unlikely that the percentage is actually 0.2. Now, this would be in favor of our alternative hypothesis, which in this case is actually opposite of our original claim. In this case, if we reject the null hypothesis, we would say there is sufficient evidence to reject the claim that the meat has at most 20% fat. The reason we're rejecting this claim instead of accepting it is that if our null hypothesis here is not true, if we're rejecting it, then that means we're rejecting it in favor of our alternative hypothesis. And again, our alternative hypothesis in this case was really the opposite of what our original claim was. So the evidence is tending to tell us that there's actually more than 20% fat in this meat in this case. Now, in the second case, if we failed to reject this null hypothesis, we're saying, okay, that could still be true. We can't say for sure, but here we would say there is not enough evidence to reject the claim that the meat has at most 20% fat. So again, this isn't saying that our original claim is true, it's just we're not saying that it's false. It could be true. All right, one last claim here. This was the claim about the steel strength. Remember, our original claim was that the standard deviation in the steel strength was exactly 0.7. Recall that our null hypothesis was actually the same as the original claim in this case. So here, in the first case, if we reject H0, if we reject the null hypothesis, we're saying that this is not true. So here, our statement would be, there is sufficient evidence to reject the claim that the steel strength varies by 0.7. So rejecting the null hypothesis in this case basically means that we would be in favor of the alternative hypothesis that the standard deviation is something other than 0.7. Now in this case we're not looking at whether it would be higher or lower, we're just saying that no, it doesn't look like it's actually 0.7. On the other hand, if we fail to reject H0, then we're saying that this could still be true. Again, we're not saying that it definitely is true. There's just not enough evidence. So here we would state, there is not sufficient evidence to reject the claim that the steel strength varies by 0.7. So it looks like our original claim could still be true. Now I know that restating these can be kind of confusing because it really depends upon what was the original claim, what is the null hypothesis, and what is the alternative hypothesis. You want to kind of think through, all right, am I rejecting the null hypothesis? What would that mean? If you are, then your alternative hypothesis is really what you're saying is likely to be true there. Or if not, what does that mean? There's a handy little table on page 391 in our textbook that looks at how you can word the conclusion based upon what the original claim looked like and whether or not you're rejecting or failing to reject the null hypothesis. So this is a good thing to use as a kind of a guideline to help you figure out what the conclusion should be here. One last thing I wanted to mention in this video is about error. And I'm not going to talk too much about this, so I really want you to read in the textbook about what type 1 and type 2 errors really look like. I'm just going to touch on it briefly here. So there's two types of errors that we can have when we do hypothesis testing. Because we can never be 100% certain about things, we're using sample data to try and conclude whether or not our statements are true. And there's two different problems that could happen. The first, the type 1 error, would be we reject the null hypothesis when it's actually true. So we're saying that the null hypothesis has a small percentage chance of being true, say less than 5%. Well, that doesn't mean that it's actually false, we're just guessing that it's false. So there's always some possibility, in that case 5%, or whatever alpha is, that we're rejecting the null hypothesis when we really shouldn't. And then the other thing that could happen is if we failed to reject the null hypothesis when it actually is false. So maybe we determine that the probability of the null hypothesis being true is 7%, and we say, okay, well that's not less than 5%, so we'll let that stand. But it still could be false, right? We can't know for sure. So this would be a type 2 error. So if you let alpha be too big, then you're increasing the chance of a type 1 error. But if you let alpha be too small, you're increasing the chance of a type 2 error. So when you actually decide what alpha should be, you have to think about which type of error would be worse. Would it be worse to say that H0 is wrong when it's actually true, or worse to say we're not sure when it actually is false? So again, I would really encourage you to read the book on this because I'm not going into a whole lot of depth, but this would be a really important thing if you were designing your own study to think about. All right, to finish up, here's a couple problems for you to try. The first one, I'm just having you write out the different claims, right? The original claim, the opposite, H0 and H1. And then in the second, I'm giving you sort of the outcome of a hypothesis test, and you have to state the conclusion in words. That's it for this video. See you next time.